general election in this week's Panorama.
These French voters can't wait to kiss the socialist dream goodbye and embrace Mrs. Thatcher's ideas. But they could end up with a government nightmare, a socialist president fighting a conservative prime minister. Northern France, under the motorway to Calais. In tunnels lived in by British soldiers in World War I under the trenches, French teenagers now go to work. The tunnels, it turns out, are ideal for growing mushrooms commercially. It's an ingenious government job scheme, but the jobs are only temporary. France has a worse youth unemployment rate than Britain, and it's the big issue in next Sunday's elections. The dying industrial areas of northern France have long been a heartland for the left. After 5 years, the longest the socialists have ever had in government, there's disappointment here they've not been socialist enough. Still, many people would agree that life is better thanks to socialist reforms. Retirement for all at 60, a fifth week's paid holiday, and the 39-hour week. There's been little social strife, inflation's way down, and those in work are better off. Angelo Bibeau is a coal miner who was made redundant. Last year, he and his wife used a government grant to set up a small business. For the whole family, it's a big break with their traditional way of life. Yet for the Bibeaus, voting socialist is traditional, a matter of conviction and class.
You see, we've been brought up in this class. It's very basic, really. I mean, we've been on the left rather than the right ever since we were kids. We've always been working class.
I believe that what voting for the left is all about is doing everything you can to make sure that as we get better off, other people who aren't so lucky get some benefit too. People whose lives are a struggle should share in the prosperity too, shouldn't they? It's important to vote for the left for a lot of reasons. To stop racism, to have more freedom, to make sure the wealth is shared out sensibly amongst everybody. It's for that more than anything. It's to improve on all that, you see, to make progress.
Anita and Angelo are in some ways exceptions. They are resourceful enough to exploit what the government has to offer, and they've the spirit to fight for themselves. They're planning to move away soon from their miner's cottage and build a new house. For many others round here, life is harder. Thousands of jobs have gone forever. The socialists promised to open new mines here. Instead, they've had to shut down more relentlessly than in Britain. For young people like the Bibeau son Gregory, the socialist response is a crash program to modernize industry and job training. They call it modernity. Among the slag heaps of this little town, the socialist symbol of modernity is a brand new comprehensive built right on top of the old pit shaft. Right-wing critics say it'll take more than symbols to lift communities like this out of the past. For the future, they're being taught to think high technology. Gregory, at 13, is already having regular classes in computer usage. The school was opened recently by the Prime Minister himself.
He said that there was some hope. He said the children were the hope of this area because they will build the country, they will build the future, and they are our future. The government wanted to make it a symbol of what could be done in French education. So we are given opportunities that are not always given to everyone, but that will be given to everyone, to every school, such as the reading room, the computer room.
The more immediate prospect for these children is daunting. The socialists promised 1 million new jobs, but couldn't deliver. Instead, unemployment's at a record high. In a new town nearby, the policy of modernité also meant pumping government subsidies into high-tech industries. In complete contrast to Britain, the socialists have made huge investments in computer manufacturing. The French make no bones about rescuing key industries if necessary.
The first action of the government, the French government, was the decision to rescue the computer industry in France 3 years ago and to invest a lot of money with the modernization funds in this industry.
And what would have happened if the socialist government hadn't done that?
The computer industry in France would have been finished now.
The plant's now breaking even, yet not a single new job has been created. That's what's causing anxiety.
We were really disappointed about that, especially as it'll affect Gregory soon.
Weren't you expecting a socialist government to do something?
Yes, of course. To do something about it. I certainly was.
And you were disappointed?
Well, yes, I was. That's really a black mark against them. They've done absolutely nothing about it.
I
think they could have at least slowed unemployment down and done more to create jobs in new industries or even develop new technologies and helped, I don't know, local craftsmen, people like that. I mean, either in helping to set up new businesses or helping young people to set themselves up. It's true, they've given some grants to young, unemployed people who want to create jobs. It's true, that's happening. And the socialist government did it. But I still don't think they've done enough.
The socialist government hasn't done enough either for what the French call the new poor. Because France has no safety net, no supplementary benefit as in Britain, the unemployed can find themselves destitute. There's a time limit on French benefits. Just down the road from the Bibos, volunteers give out free food to anyone who comes in off the street. It's a kind of domestic Bob Geldof operation, which gives out 100,000 food parcels a day all over France. They call these places restaurants of the heart because the food comes from donations, raised from Live Aid-type TV appeals.
Merci.
It's left the socialist government deeply embarrassed. The Bibos are aware of their good fortune. Having gone into business to supply medical equipment, they see a chance to make a decent living. So why aren't they attracted by the economic incentives the right is promising?
Because there'll be more promises. And 5, 10, 20 years will go by and it'll still be the same. Well, they were in for 20 years and they didn't do much, did they?
Those right-wing governments stayed in for 20-odd years, didn't they? So why not give a few more years to the left? It'd be a pity not to try to get them in again.
President Mitterrand is not up for election on Sunday. The presidential elections aren't until 1988. But Mitterrand's descended into the campaign because he looks like losing his socialist government. If the voters switch to a right-wing parliament, The president will be on the spot. He'll have to choose a right-wing prime minister. France has never had a president and prime minister from totally opposed parties. Their tug of war in government could be chaotic. Mitterrand hasn't always been the socialist hero. After only a year, he was forced into a massive U-turn. Now he recalls only the advances under socialism.
Je demande à ce peuple qui m'écoute de préserver ses acquis, de préserver ses conquêtes, de préserver le résultat de lutte légitime.
Another, more affluent France. A few minutes' drive from Grenoble in the Alps. Before getting in a full day on the slopes next Sunday, the Abba family will make doubly sure they vote first.
Allez, on y va, là.
Allez, en avant.
Olivier works in middle management in an American computer firm.
Allez.
He and his wife have two small sons. The outlook for them is not so bleak. Olivier acknowledges Mitterrand's U-turn, but he finds it hard to forgive the socialist economic experiment.
I think we have to be very realistic and make sure that everyone understands that the socialists came in with wild ideas, thinking that they could do whatever they wanted for France without taking into account the overall economic and worldwide environment that we are in. And that's, I think, the major mistake that I can point out. I don't think we've done that well. I think our living standards, if you look back around 1980, have gone down. We are paying more taxes than we were before, income taxes. We are having to pay more social security contribution, and the social security benefits at the same time have gone down. So I think, you know, in order to allow a minority of people to improve its own standard of living, the vast majority of the French people is not well off. Their standard of living has gone down.
But still, it's the good life here. The French middle classes like to complain about the ground they've lost and the way property values went down under the socialists. Olivier's got clear ideas of what's gone wrong and the unpopular steps needed to put it right.
We had 3 devaluations in about 3 years. Our budget deficit got larger and larger. Then our trade balances went really very bad for the first 2 years as a result of the socialist decisions. And unemployment kept going up until 2.4 million French people are today unemployed. So in a nutshell, those are my 4 major complaints. I think it's the attitude. The state-controlled economy is still very well entrenched in the mind of the socialists. And I don't think that's what is needed for France as a whole. What we need is more freedom in prices, in allowing entrepreneurs to create businesses, in allowing businessmen to lay off when they have to. That sense of freedom, I think, cannot be given by the socialist government. If the right has a very large majority, they can go on with those measures. That doesn't mean that we won't have strikes, we won't have demonstrations in the streets, but I think the government will feel that they have enough momentum, enough people behind them to enact those measures.
Grenoble has become a high-tech boom town with below-average unemployment. It's a center for nuclear research, and many computer firms have made it their headquarters. Grenoble's an old university city with a large student population. In 1981, it too went socialist. But in local elections, it's already swung back to the right. The city's professional classes were all in favor of socialist reforms like the new wealth tax, until they found it hit them where it hurt.
Et maintenant, vous respirez, respirez, soufflez, videz vos poumons, videz, 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 videz. Maintenant, regonflez, gonflez très vite, très fort et soufflez, soufflez très vite, très bien. Bravo, soufflez, soufflez. Allez, 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 bien à fond. Respirez tranquillement, respirez tranquillement.
Professor Brambilla's diagnosis of the socialist performance is based more in sorrow than in anger.
When Mitterrand arrived, there was a kind of dream in France. A lot of people thought everything was going to be better. We were going to have more money and work less. At the beginning, the socialists took the money from the very rich people and everybody. But the very rich agreed with that, but it was 200 or 1,000 people in France. But it was not enough to have enough money to pay for all the social reform. So they had to ask the money to increase the taxes to the middle class. And when that arrived...
People like you.
People like me didn't agree anymore to pay all this money for social reform. And we were afraid that this money was wasted and so on. And so these people really get afraid and they didn't want to continue this way.
Examen histologique d'une tumeur pulmonaire. À la ligne, les prélèvements ont concerné une...
Christian's wife, Elisabeth, thought socialism was worth a try.
De taille moyenne, point final, fin de compte rendu.
A middle-class conservative with a social conscience, she voted socialist in 81, but is now switching her allegiance again.
I chose to vote for Mitterrand. Changes were necessary. And mainly for the working people. I think that I thought that there is no reason to accept to live in a society where 50% of the people are so unhappy, and that we could make something for them with a new government, and that Mitterrand was safe enough to make this job fairly well.
When you say safe enough, what do you mean by that?
Safe enough because I think that I was pretty sure that he was not, he would not making a communist politic. And even he was probably able to adapt the socialism politic. I think that what is done will not be lost anyway by these people. And that is a good point for me.
If it's a good point, why do you want to change it?
I think that it could have been better, and that it could be better with a right government now.
Prime Minister, what's your response to people who voted for you last time who are now saying it'll be better with a government of the right?
No, because if there was a government of the right, their policy would be very different. Fiscal policy would be different, social policy would be different. They'd be reactionary policies. We're socialists. But at the same time, we've adapted ourselves to reality. It's not forbidden to be both a socialist and a realist. When we came in, there were high hopes because we'd been out of power for over 20 years. People wanted it all to go much faster. But I told them, in government, it's the same as in your own lives. You can't do everything in 5 years. We've already changed quite a few things. If you want us to do more, you must give us another term.
A campaign tour with the Prime Minister. This is the rural face of French socialism. The vine growers of the southwest haven't had an easy time under the socialists, but it's still a left-wing bastion. Fabius was promoted by Mitterrand to put a youthful, modern face on the socialist economic U-turn. He's had a rough passage as prime minister. His government has always been struggling. Fabius knows it'll take a miracle next Sunday to stave off defeat. But as the lead man in the campaign, he's trying to salvage as many socialist seats as he can. For a low-key performer, he's become a smooth campaigner. But he's also an unusually candid politician.
France didn't suddenly become socialist. Some people are socialists, but plenty of people voted for us because they wanted to throw out the government. Today, we're the government. But people are becoming more aware of the changes we've made, and nobody can challenge our achievements. When we came into office, inflation was 14%. We've got it down to below 4%. We've also increased purchasing power, and we've begun to modernize industry. That leaves unemployment. In my view, it's our only big problem. We're doing rather better than some other countries I won't mention, but it's true, we're not doing well enough.
Chanting victory may be the nearest the socialists will get to it. The big irony of this campaign is that under Fabius, the socialists have climbed back from the deep unpopularity of 2 years ago, yet still there'll be no election victory. And that's because they've lost their major ally. 2 years ago, Mitterrand finally broke with the communists, who left his government and will now again be competing for votes. With a united front no longer possible on the left, the socialists set about changing the rules. They've introduced proportional representation to try to keep more seats than they'd otherwise have got. Making every vote count is Fabius's old-fashioned appeal.
Je souhaite que la politique de progrès continue. Je souhaite que des ministres socialistes continuent. Je souhaite, parce que j'aime comme vous mon pays, que la stabilité et le calme social continuent. Je vous demande une seule chose d'ici le 16 mars, c'est matin, soir, et s'il est nécessaire la nuit même, de vous mobiliser en avant pour le succès. Vive la République!
Perhaps startled by the fire of a man they regard as a social democrat, the activists sing the Internationale to remind Fabius of their roots in revolutionary socialism. Where he's been the mayor for the past 9 years, the man reckoned most likely to be France's next prime minister. Jacques Chirac, leader of the largest party on the right, the Gaullists, is known as France's most avid campaigner. There are half a dozen politicians on the right who all want to be leader. Chirac saw that the way to win was to unite their squabbling parties and leave the leadership until later. They've agreed not to compete for seats. In most places, Chirac's Gaullists and their partners on the right are running joint candidates to make their votes count. What's more, they've agreed a joint manifesto. Like Mrs. Thatcher's, it promises to protect the welfare state.
Voilà.
Oh, merci, Monsieur Chirac.
Madame Bachelon, au revoir.
Au revoir, Monsieur Chirac.
Au revoir, Madame.
But the right are also committed to cut public spending, abolish socialist controls, and make a return to the free market the basis for restoring France's economic confidence.
When the confidence came back, well, everything changed. and the people are much more dynamic. You can see that in many countries, in a very different context. It is what happened in the United States.
What about Britain? Mrs. Thatcher has been conducting your kind of policies, but one thing it doesn't produce is a reduction in unemployment.
Well, Mrs. Thatcher's policy had good results, but that's true. It didn't reduce the unemployment. But may I say that she had not, or she were not able to, reduce taxes. And this is one very important point.
Chirac won't follow Mrs. Thatcher. The left equals unemployment, a common right-wing slogan. So to wipe it out, Chirac promises big tax cuts. It's the election issue on which he's least convincing. The Marseille connection with French politics has an exotic quality all its own, and it's disturbing. The second city of France has been a left-wing stronghold for decades. But as the port of entry for immigrants from North Africa, it's now upsetting all previous political calculations. All along the Riviera during Mitterrand's presidency, people have been switching from the left to the extreme right. They're voting for the anti-immigration party, the National Front, because they believe the socialists are soft on Arab immigration. Proportional representation will allow the National Front into Parliament for the first time, a prospect which has made French politics more vicious.
The key behind the rise of the National Front is the feeling of insecurity. I don't know if it's the right word in English, but people see that they are robbed. There are cars in the streets, you know, your radio is pulled out. You have drugs in schools, high school, college. And they don't feel that really the socialist government has really done much for that.
Crime, violence, and immigration have become a political grievance. It's forcing the traditional right-wing parties into a corner. Whatever they say, a disturbingly large number of voters aren't satisfied.
They say they're right-wing, but they're not. Chirac. You know what I call him? Shishi the marshmallow. What a wet he is, that man. He's all over the place.
This man's a taxi driver who'll be voting National Front for the first time, because he blames conventional politicians for changing the face of France. Proportional representation gives people like him the hope of electing a National Front candidate to Parliament and a chance to influence policy.
To crack down on all this violence, first of all, what you got to do is send all your foreign criminals back where they came from. And if all the immigrant workers who are out of a job were repatriated, with compensation, of course, you'd put an end to unemployment in France straight away, wouldn't you? And if everyone was working, there wouldn't be anybody wandering about the streets at night trying to do other people in. If they know they've got to get up to go to work in the morning, they'll go to bed at night. So, you're already 50% better off, aren't you?
There are certain smells here and a certain type of music you get in the shops which, frankly, is offensive to the ordinary people of Marseille. The whole atmosphere here is such that people just don't feel at home in their own city anymore. The French, for the most part, fought against the German invasion, against the Nazis. Well, today, we're not going to allow the Third World to invade us.
Mm-hmm. The Marseille organizer of the National Front topped the poll last year in a local election with 30% of the vote. Astonishingly, he's been a long-time member of the French Communist Party.
In our electorate here, I'd say we're getting 50% of the old communist vote at a minimum. That's people currently voting for the National Front.
Isn't that incredible?
No, it's not incredible.
The communists are fed up too?
Yes, absolutely they are. Your Communist Party voters are ordinary people, after all, workers like me. Not very well off, and they are the people who are up against these immigration problems. The left tries to deny there is a problem, so they've cut themselves off from their traditional supporters. Instead, those people have turned to the National Front for a solution to their problems.
Maybe the right government will have to work with these people. And, well, I don't like this. I don't like Front National. I think it's dangerous, and I don't want to see these people speaking for France in the national parliament. That's very dangerous.
If you and your partners on the right fail to win an absolute majority, would you prefer not to govern at all rather than rely on the National Front?
Not to govern.
Not to govern at all?
Not to govern at all.
That categorical assurance at national level doesn't extend to Chirac's allies in Marseille. After next Sunday's elections, they might not be so fussy. They see a chance of throwing the socialists out all along the Riviera. If the only way to do it is with the help of the National Front, they're not saying no.
I'm not ruling anything out. You ever known candidates to refuse votes? They don't even do that in Great Britain.
In Paris, at the biggest election meeting of the campaign, the Gaullist faithful gather in tens of thousands to consecrate their leader. As the election approaches, Jacques Chirac has been behaving more and more like a prime minister, even like a president. Chirac assures everyone that a socialist president and a conservative prime minister should reach a reasonable working arrangement. Cohabitation, the French call it. And Chirac has laid down his condition, that when Mitterrand appoints him prime minister, the president must agree to implement the policies the right's been elected on.
There is no problem. We have a constitution, which is a parliamentary constitution, and which give the real power to the prime minister. The president in France has two types of powers. Powers coming from the constitution, which are small powers, and nobody contests those powers. And powers which comes from the fact that he is the leader of the majority. If he is no more the leader of the majority, he loses these powers, and he has only the first one, which are small ones, and the prime minister has the main powers.
Now, what would happen in foreign policy? For instance, a matter that concerns Britain directly. Mrs. Thatcher is very proud of the common market budget repayment agreed with President Mitterrand. What would happen to that?
Well, we have to reinforce the strength of Europe. I don't want to open such a quarrel. But when the time comes to discuss this problem, we shall have to discuss it. The prime minister in France will have to discuss it with a view of reinforcing the strength of Europe, and will ask to Great Britain if she wants to keep these advantages, to give more help and more will to strengthen the Europe community.
Chirac's extraordinary presumptuousness is echoed by his Gaullist supporters. After 12 years on the outside, they're celebrating a return to power. The world may have got used to a strong French president, but Chirac wants it to get used to the idea of a strong French prime minister.
Nous avons la volonté de réussir. Si nous en avons les moyens, rien ni personne ne nous en empêchera. Soyez confiants, soyez résolus, ayez confiance en la France, soyez heureux, c'est demain que commence le renouveau. Vive la République et vive la France!
Chirac hasn't quite achieved liftoff. The gaullist bubble could still be burst on Sunday by the voters. If the right fail to get their absolute majority, then nothing is guaranteed. Chirac, after all, is offering France a trip into the unknown, perhaps a bumpy ride. After 30 years' stability, the French seem about to vote perversely for a system of cohabitation that could cause upheavals. Well over half the French say they want cohabitation to work, but don't think it can.
I think that is a big, big problem. I don't imagine how it can work. I don't see any person like, for example, Chirac, able to govern the country with Chirac as first minister.
We were used to have the president and the government of the same party. And I think this is going to create problems inside France. People won't understand what's going on, really.
I should think it'll be more like non-cohabitation, won't it?
It won't be living together. It'll be living in separate bedrooms.
Not like a marriage, then.
Not at all. There's a big difference.
President Mitterrand is said never to thrive so much as when he's up against it. But he's made clear he won't be dictated to. He won't, he says, be a cut-price president. He won't be stripped of key powers, and it's he who chooses the prime minister. But it's on the gut issues of social and economic policy that president and prime minister could soon come to blows. The size of next Sunday's majority will decide the president's freedom of maneuver. If the right only managed to scrape home, Mitterrand will doubtless display all his political skills to make sure that if next Sunday it is au revoir to socialism, it's not necessarily a final farewell.
Producer of that programme, Cathy O'Neill, and John Simpson, the BBC's diplomatic editor, report on the French election in this Thursday's edition of The Listener magazine. And Radio 4 will carry special election reports this Sunday evening at 6, 8:30 and 10 o'clock.
A once-in-a-lifetime meeting this Thursday, live on BBC One. From the dawn of civilization, mankind has recorded the appearance of this ethereal traveller of the universe. From 2,000-year-old Chinese astrological charts to the famous Bayer tapestry celebrating 1066, men have marveled at this mysterious object in the night sky, sometimes believing it to have supernatural powers in predicting great events. After its latest visit to Earth, Halley's Comet is already on course back towards the icy wastes of outer space. But before it leaves, man now has his first chance to visit this apparition that has haunted Earth for countless centuries. On Thursday, the frail and vulnerable spacecraft Giotto enters the dangerous bow wave of Halley's Comet in a hail of space dust and debris. Join Giotto for this spectacular once-in-a-lifetime meeting this Thursday night, live at 11 o'clock on BBC One.